A very good evening to all of you. Good evening, sir. I'll begin in 1 to 2 minutes. I think people are joining right now. So in today's class, we will be completing till the independence portion, and moreover, there will be some sections left which will be completed in 1 or 2 more classes. So after that, you will have the test, and the test will be on Sunday for Modern India. And some of you have not submitted the test, and I am waiting for your tests. Tanya submitted it successfully, and she has also got it evaluated, and she has also got the model answers. So if you are looking for the model answers or you want the test to be evaluated, you can submit it to me. I'll just wait for a minute and then I'll begin. Yes, Shreya, this is a problem which students often face, that they are not able to complete the test on time. When I take the answer writing class, when you have ample of time, you are able to write good answers. And another thing is, Shreya, I have not received your copy. If you have submitted it or something, then please check. I have not received your copy. I was waiting for your test. I have not got it. 2 to 3 people have asked me for extra time, and I have given them, but only Tanya was the only student who submitted the test on that day. So I am beginning the class now. See, yesterday the individual Satyagraha, August offer, and the basically now the Cripps mission also failed, and the government, basically the Congress, was now sure that the Britishers are not serious for giving us independence. So now the chapter 23. Quit India Movement, Demand for Pakistan, and the INA. Now, Quit India Movement. After Cripps' departure, Gandhi framed a resolution calling for British withdrawal and a non-violent, non-cooperation movement against any Japanese invasion. So basically, The Congress was aware that we cannot challenge the British directly because it would have brought a lot of suppression and lot of draconian laws from the Britishers. So what they did was, in the Gandhiji framed a resolution which called for movement against any Japanese invasion. So why start a struggle now? See, because initially Gandhiji was saying we will not take care, we will not these. So why is it that he has launched a struggle now? Now the failure of the Cripps mission to solve the constitutional deadlock expressed Britain's unchanged attitude on constitutional advance. So basically it was sure that Britishers do not want to do anything for us. Made it clear that any more silence would tantamount to accepting the British right to decide the fate of Indians without consulting them. So basically, even if we did not do anything now, then it will show as if we are not, we have given every right to the Britishers and they will be deciding whatever happens to us. So there was a popular discontent because of the rising prices of shortage of rice, salt, etc. So there were news of reverses suffered by the British in Southeast Asia, and imminent British collapse enhanced popular willingness to give expression to the discontent. The Japanese troops were approaching the borders of India. So basically the news that the Britishers are unable to protect us, that created a lot of hue and cry in the government, so in the people. So people started leaving the British, and then they thought that now we should protect ourselves on our own. So that was the another reason that Indians wanted to move wanted to start a movement. Now, now the manner in which British evacuated from the southeast, leaving the subjects to their fate. So two roads are provided, black road for Indian refugees and white road exclusively for European refugees. So basically when the war was going on, the British attacked, Japanese attacked the British, and what they did was, in Southeast Asia, they had occupied Southeast Asia as well. So what they did at that time was, they provided two roads. So there was a road, one road was exclusively reserved for Europeans. So look at their racism and their basically inhuman nature, that they helped all the Europeans to get out of that place before the Japanese attacked, but they left the Indians the roads were not well made properly, and the way to go out was also not very good. And the rout of the European power by Asian power shattered the white prestige, and the British behavior towards the Indian subjects in East Asia exposed the racist attitudes of the rulers. So this is the other problem, that they were very racist and they did not give us the right to save ourselves. There was no way to protect ourselves at that time, and Indians could not move out from that area. Okay, so Indians were not given equal chances to move out from that area. So these two problems, their bad attitude and the way they left the subjects basically after they lost the war, it was very heartbreaking. The leadership wanted to condition the masses for possible Japanese invasion. So the Congress leadership was prepared to mentally prepare the people so that there can be a Japanese invasion and we need to take care. So now a Quit India resolution. Congress Working Committee met at Wardha and authorized Gandhiji to take charge of the non-violent mass movement. Quit India resolution proposed by Jawaharlal Nehru and seconded by Sardar Patel. So basically you have to remember that it was proposed by Nehru and seconded by Sardar Patel. Now what was the resolution? It demanded immediate end to British rule in India, declared the commitment to free India to defend itself against fascism and imperialism, provisional government of India after the British withdrawal, sanction a civil disobedience movement against the British rule, and Gandhi was named the leader of the struggle. So all of these things were in the Quit India resolution. Now Gandhiji gave instructions to different sections. The reason being that he was aware that as soon as this movement will be launched, so the government will cripple us. by taking all the Congress leaders and putting them in jail. So he gave clear instructions beforehand. So he started giving instructions to government servants that do not resign, but declare your allegiance to Congress. Soldiers were said to leave, do not leave the army, but do not fire on compatriots. So basically, soldiers were the people on the back. Basically, army was the backbone through which the British were able to make such a huge empire in India. So this demand was made by Gandhiji, asking soldiers not to fire on Indians anymore. Students, if confident, leave studies. Peasants were asked that if the zamindars are anti-government, pay mutually agreed rent, and if the zamindars are pro-government, do not pay rent. Princes, support the masses and accept sovereignty of your people. He asked the princely states and the princes to accept the sovereignty of the people, and princely states people were asked to support the ruler only if he was anti-British and declare yourself to be part of the Indian nation. So basically, earlier all the proposals which were given, they said that if any part of India wanted to make a separate constitution or wanted to be a separate unit, it could go and leave the Indian Union. So in this case, Gandhiji is asking the people of the princely states to become a part of India. And he gave the mantra, do or die. We shall either free India or die in the attempt. We shall not live to see the perpetuation of our slavery. Now, spread of the movement. Basically, you see that August 9, in a single sweep, all the top leaders of the Congress were arrested and taken to unknown destinations. So basically, it is very clear that as soon as this movement was launched, it was curbed by the British. The Congress Working Committee, the All India Congress Committee, and the Provincial Congress Committees were declared unlawful associations under the Criminal Law 1908. The assembly of public meetings was prohibited under Article 56 of the Defence of India Rules. Now, with the leaders out of the picture, youngsters came to the forefront. They were young Aruna Asaf Ali, presided over the Congress Committee session on August 9 and hoisted the flag. Public went on rampage. See, as soon as the public got the message from Gandhiji to start a movement, and as soon as they got to know that Gandhiji is arrested, so they were very anxious that where are all the leaders. So Gandhiji had a place in each and every person's heart in the country, because his sacrifices were second to none. His methods, his sacrifices had brought justice to so many people that the public went on rampage. Public attacked the symbols of authority and hoisted national flags on public buildings. Satyagrahis offered themselves to arrest. Bridges were blown up, railway tracks were removed, and telegraph lines were cut. Now, students responded by going on strike in schools and colleges, participating in processions, writing and disputing illegal news sheets, these were called patrikas, and acting as couriers for underground network, and workers went on strike. Now, underground activity. So basically, Ram Manohar Lohia, Jai Prakash Narayan, Aruna Asaf Ali, Usha Mehta, Biju Patnaik, all of these started underground activities. Usha Mehta started an underground radio in Bombay. So underground activities are those, basically the revolutionary kind of activities. Now, parallel governments. Parallel governments mean that people are listening to them. They are acting as the government now. They are the supreme authority in that area. Now, in Balia, in August 1942, under Chittu Pandey, a parallel government was made. In Tamulk, Jatiya Sarkar was formed, and it undertook cyclone relief work and sanctioned grants to school, supplied paddy from the rich to poor, and organized Vidyut Vahinis. In Satara, it was named Prati Sarkar, and it was organized by Y.B. Chavan and Nana Patel. Now, extent of mass participation. The youth participated in large numbers. Women were also there. Prominent were Aruna Asaf Ali, Sucheta Kriplani, and Usha Mehta. Workers were also there. Peasants of all strata were at the heart of the movement, and some zamindars also participated. Government officials, especially those belonging to the lower level in police and administration, participated, resulting in erosion of the government loyalty. So now basically those persons who are also part of the government services, and especially at the lower levels, they started supporting the Indian movement. So it was actually a very big loss for the British. Now, Muslims helped by giving shelter to underground activists. There were no clashes during the movement. Communists did not join the movement. In the wake of Russia being attacked by Nazi Germany, the communists began to support the British war against Germany, and the imperialist war became a people's war. So basically, communists were people who wanted, who were following the ideology of the USSR. Inspired by the Russian Revolution, they followed the ideology of the USSR. Now, they did not join the movement because Hitler started attacking Russia. In the World War II, you will read when we'll be doing Indian world history that Germany under Hitler attacked Russia as well. So Russia and Britain have now become allies in the war. So Russia and Britain are on the same side, and since the communists are the root of their ideology is from Russia, and they see in the USSR Russia their major ally, so they did not support the movement. So they thought that this movement will weaken Britain, and in hence it will weaken the Russian sovereignty as well, because Russia was being attacked by Germany. So they were earlier calling the war as an imperialist war, and now this war became a people's war. People's war because they said that now it is protecting the people because Britain is with Russia. The Muslim League opposed the movement, and the Hindu Mahasabha boycotted the movement. Princely states show a low-key response. Now, government repression. There was no government repression. Basically, they are saying that government repressed the movement very hard. Basically, now the World War II was an unprecedented war. So you can imagine that under normal circumstances, Britishers were repressing us so much, and so what would they do now? So there was no limit to the kind of repression they did now, and now there was nothing which could stop them. Okay, so now we will be doing the next thing. Okay, estimate. Left without leaders, there was no restraint, and violence became common. So basically, earlier when Gandhiji used to be there, he used to ask the people to be non-violent, but now there was nobody to restrain the people. Students, workers and peasants were the backbone, and upper classes in the bureaucracy largely remained loyal. So they became, the upper classes and the bureaucrats were loyal to the British. Loyalty to the government suffered erosion because there were many lower workers, basically in the lower grades of the services. They started supporting the Congress. It was no longer possible to rule India without the wishes of Indians. Spontaneity was higher than before. The demand for independence was the immediate agenda of the national movement. After Quit India, there was no retreat. Common people displayed unparalleled heroism and militancy. Gandhi fasts. See now, Gandhiji was in jail, and he was basically, government was beating up the people. So against it, he made a fast. The fast was directed against the violence of the state. Protests were organized at home and abroad through hartals, demonstration and strikes. Three members of the Viceroy's Executive Council resigned. The fast achieved the following. Public morale was raised, anti-British feeling was heightened, an opportunity was provided for political activity, government's high-handedness was exposed, and Gandhiji got the better of his opponents and refused to oblige by dying. So basically what was happening is that Gandhiji was the leader of the masses, and so he decided that because he has been captured and he is not being able to do anything directly, so he decided to fast, and his fasts always had a very motivating factor to the people. So he started fasting, and the morale of the people was boosted. The Britishers were caught in a fix. They asked him to break the fast, and he said, "I will not break the fast, I would rather die." So the whole situation became very explosive, and Gandhiji went on a fast to support the movement. Now, famine of 1943. Now, when all of these things were happening, there was a great famine in India. Around 1.5 million to 3 million people perished in this man-made famine. So do you see that around 15 to 30 lakh people died, and the population of India was not as much as it is now. See, there was famine, epidemics, malaria, cholera, smallpox, malnutrition, starvation, and the causes were that there was enough food produced in the country, but it was taken away to feed the army. Rice imports from Burma and Southeast Asia had been stopped. So Japan had defeated Burma and Southeast Asia. So now Japan stopped the rice which was coming from Burma to India. So already there was a lot of stress on the food grains, and rice was stopped. So this created huge problem for the country. The famine got aggravated by gross mismanagement and deliberate profiteering. So basically corruption was there at that time also. Rationing methods were belated and confined to big cities. So the British did make some efforts to ration the foods, but they were confined only to big cities. Now when all of these things were happening, Mr. Rajgopalachari gave a formula. He gave a formula for the Congress League cooperation. Now Muslim League will endorse Congress demand for independence. Now basically the main problem is that all of the parties, basically the Muslims and the Congress, Muslim League and the Congress, are not able to bring a joint demand. Every time the Congress asks for independence, the British prop up the Muslim League to give some concessions to them, either they give some guarantees to them, and the whole process of independence is thwarted. So now C. Rajgopalachari is giving a formula so that Congress and the League can together put up the demands. Basically he is saying that condition will be that Muslim League will endorse Congress's demand for independence. So he is saying Muslim League will agree to independence. League will cooperate with Congress in forming a provisional government. So basically they will also form the government which will come up right now. Then after the end of the World War, the entire population of the Muslim majority areas in the Northwest and the Northeast to decide by plebiscite. So basically the areas which are at present Pakistan and Bangladesh, the C. Rajgopalachari is saying that all the people who are there in these areas will now come up and do a plebiscite whether they want to form a separate state or not. And in the case of acceptance, the agreement to be made for safeguarding defense, commerce and communication. So basically he is saying that when they will be decided that they want to make a separate nation, then we will make a common center. Basically center will be common, which will have defense, commerce and communication. Rest all of the things will be given to autonomous units, basically the area of Pakistan, the area of Bangladesh and the rest of India. It will have a common union government with the defense, commerce and communications, and rest of the functions will be given to these units, and there will be a single unit. Now the above terms were operative only if English transferred full powers to India. Now there will be objections by Jinnah. See, Jinnah wanted Congress to accept the two nation theory. He wanted only the Muslims to vote in plebiscite and not the entire population. He was also opposed to the idea of common center. So now see these points, basically here it is written that entire population will vote. Now Jinnah is saying no, the entire population will not vote, only the Muslims will vote from these areas whether they want a new state or not. If they say yes, then they will get the new state. Now he is setting in here, it was written that there will be a common center for jointly safeguarding defense. He is saying I do not want a common center, accept the two nation theory, accept that Hindus and Muslims cannot be a single country. So that is what the Jinnah is demanding, and C. Rajgopalachari formula will also go to waste. Now Desai Liaquat Pact. Now a draft proposal for the formation of interim government consisting of equal number of persons nominated by the Congress and the League in the central legislature. So now Desai and Bhullah Bhai Desai and Liaquat Ali Khan, both are prominent leaders. Desai is from the Congress and Liaquat Ali Khan is from the Muslim League. They have drafted a proposal that to form an interim government. Interim government means the government which will come up right now for the effective transfer of power from the British. There what will happen, equal number of persons will be nominated by the Congress and the League in the central legislature. 20% of the seats will be reserved for minorities, and no settlement could be reached between the Congress and the League on these lines. but a fact, a sort of parity between the Congress and the League was decided upon. So basically, when this is also given, the League is not accepting it. So here you can see that he has given 50% seats to them, basically equal seats are given. So here also the Britishers are not, the Muslim League is not accepting the demands. So here what will happen is that a kind of parity is created between the Muslim League and the Congress. Parity in the sense that he is giving equal seats to them. So in that sense there is a parity. And now whatever the Muslim League will ask from after this, they know that this is the minimum we will get, because Congress is offering this on its own, that please take half the seats, we will take half the seats. So less than this they will never accept from now, and we will plan. Now war in Europe came to an end in 1945, but the Japanese were still fighting the war and they were still a threat. Now Britain, led by Churchill, was keen to reach a solution on the constitutional question in India. Now why did he want a solution now? See, the general election in England was scheduled and the Conservatives wanted to be seen as sincere on reaching a solution. So by now the question of India had become a major problem for the British, because there was more expenses in India now and less income. By this time the Raj was not profitable because they had already taken the money which they could. India was extremely poor by now, and the people were creating problem. Europeans were dying in India. Revolutionaries were acting. There was a major law and order problem in the country. So moreover, there were pressure from the Allies to seek Indian cooperation in the war. So now Indian people were not cooperating so much in the war, but it was required to win the war effectively. Indian cooperation was required. So the British government wanted to divert Indian energies more profitable to the British. Right now Indian energies were used in a manner that we can attack the British or we can subvert the British. Now the plan was to reconstruct the Governor General's Executive Council pending the preparation of a new constitution. So basically they will modify the Governor General's Executive Council to bring in some changes so that Indians can also be given representation. Now what are the things given by this Wavell plan? Now what are the things they are giving? With the exception of the Governor General and the Commander in Chief, all the members will be Indians. Caste Hindus and Muslims will be equal representation. So basically caste Hindu means that other than the depressed classes, those who are from the upper sections of the Indian castes, they and the Muslims will have equal representation in the Executive Council. The council will function as an interim government within the framework of 1935 Act, and this will not be responsible to the Central Assembly. So because we have studied the 1935 Act, we know that the executive at that time was not responsible to the Central Assembly. Governor General was to exercise his veto on the advice of ministers. So earlier Governor General had a lot of veto and he could exercise his veto and stop anything which was going on. But now he could use his veto only on the advice of the ministers. So basically those who are nominated to the Executive Council, minister means them. Representative of different parties were to submit a joint list to the Viceroy for nominations, and possibilities were kept open for the negotiation of a new constitution once the war was finally won. Now Muslim League, what did see? Now Muslim League is very adamant that we want a Pakistan. So what will it do now? The Muslim League is saying that all the Muslims have to be member, basically all those who will be nominated to the Executive Council, and the Muslims which will be nominated will be only nominated by the League. So this is a condition that the League is putting up. So now the League claimed some kind of a veto in the council with the decisions opposed to Muslims needing 2/3 majority for the approval. So basically another thing which they said is, now if any decision is opposed to the Muslims, that will require 2/3 of the majority for approval. And now there are three sections. One is the caste Hindus, the Muslims and the depressed classes or others, basically Sikhs, Anglo-Indians, Christians, everybody else, they press passes. Then there is Hindus and caste Hindus, and then there are Muslims. So the executive council is divided into three. So now they are saying that in the council, if any decision will be opposed to Muslims, it will require 2/3 of majority for approval. So now it is saying basically that nothing can be done without our wishes. Congress's stand. So now Congress said that it is an attempt to reduce Congress to a status of caste Hindu party and insisted on the right to include members from all communities. So now Congress is saying, no, we will not do this. We want all the communities to be a member of our party. Now Wavell's mistake. Now what Wavell did? Wavell announced the breakdown of talks, thus giving the League a virtual veto. So now basically the League was not agreeing to this plan, though it could have been worked upon. So Wavell, without giving more time for the talks to proceed, he snapped the talks and said that this is not going on further because the League is not agreeing. So this strengthened the League's position, and it was evident from the elections which will happen now. Now basically the League is saying, I will not agree, but there were many more people in the country. And they could have taken their advice as well, but they are not taking their advice. Okay, they are not taking their advice, so this is the Wavell's mistake, and he has given an upper hand to the Muslim League. Now meanwhile, during all of these developments were taking place, the Indian National Army under Bose was also active. In March 1940, Bose convened an anti-compromise conference at Ramgarh. It was joint effort of the Forward Bloc and the Kisan Sabha. A worldwide struggle should be launched on April 6. So this is what he is saying. A worldwide struggle will be launched. So now we remember that after the World War was launched, there were three positions. One was by Gandhiji, who said that I will support the British as a matter of duty. Second was Nehru, who said, I do not support the British, but I will also not take advantage of their position. Third was Bose, who said that this is the best opportunity and we should fight the British right now. We should end their rule right now. We will not get a better opportunity any other time. So ultimately Congress adopted Nehru's stand, and Bose then went away from the Congress, and he convened an anti-compromise conference with the Forward Bloc and Kisan Sabha. He said, we will launch a worldwide struggle. Now, with a call to the people not to help the imperialist war with any resource, men, money or materials. See, because he will make such proclamations, he was naturally arrested. So Bose was arrested and he was released from prison and placed under house arrest in December 1940, after he went on a hunger strike. Now in January 1941, it was reported that Bose had escaped. On January 26, he reached Peshawar under the pseudonym Ziauddin, helped by Bhagat Ram. He then left India to supplement from outside the struggle going on at home. So basically we have studied earlier that there was a Ghadar type revolution which was taking place outside India. Many revolutionaries were working outside India. So at this time, Bose also decided that he will leave India and help the movement of India from outside. So he approached Russia for help in the Indian struggle for freedom. Now, but what happened is that Hitler attacked Russia. So Russia favored Britain now. So Britain and Russia became partners, and Bose left for Germany. He met Hitler under the pseudonym Orlando Mazzotta. With the help of Hitler, he formed the Freedom Army, which consisted of all the prisoners of war of Indian origin captured by Germany and Italy. He gave the famous slogan Jai Hind. In 1943, he left Germany and travelled by German and later by Japanese submarines to reach Japan and then Singapore in July of the same year. So basically, he has left Germany also now. Then he is going to Japan, and from Japan he is taking over the command of the Indian independence movement from Ras Bihari Bose. We studied in the revolutionary activities that Ras Bihari Bose was very instrumental in organizing revolutionary activities in India, and later he went for Japan. He left for Japan after he was about to be caught. Now, origin and first phase of Indian National Army. So basically, the original idea of the Indian National Army was not of Bose. See, the idea of creating an army out of Indian prisoners of war was originally that of Mohan Singh. So he was an Indian army officer who had lost the war. He was working under the British. British lost the war, and he decided to ask the retreating forces for help. Now basically Japan had defeated Britain in one area, so he asked the British that please let us make a force so that we can fight with you against the British. By the end of 1942, 40,000 men were ready to join the INA. It was intended that the INA would go into action only on the invitation of Indian National Congress and the people of India. The move to form this army has been seen by many as a check against the misconduct of the Japanese against Indians in Southeast Asia and a bulwark against possible future Japanese occupation of India. So basically, one reason was that they will help to take out the British from India. Second thing was that they will check misconduct of the Japanese against Indians in Southeast Asia. So in Southeast Asia, there were many Indians at that time as well. Some of them had been taken by British, some of them went by their own wish, and some of them were taken through the army. So they decided that they will protect the Indians in Southeast Asia as well. And secondly, it will be a basic shield against any Japanese occupation of India. So if they will also be with the Japanese and they will come in, enter India with the Japanese, they can avoid a Japanese rule from taking India. INA got a boost with the outbreak of Quit India movement in India. So as soon as a Quit India movement was launched in India, the Indian National Army started having more and more subscriptions. So now, with the Japanese contemplating an Indian invasion, and the idea of armed wing of INA seemed more relevant to them. So now the Japanese were also thinking of attacking India, British India. So they also thought that if we will have Indian men, it will be helpful. But soon issues emerged between the Indian army officers led by Mohan Singh and the Japanese over the role. Now Japanese wanted only 2000 people, but Mohan Singh was thinking that I have 40,000 people, so I will take them. But this issue started, and Mohan Singh could not do a lot because Mohan Singh was only a basically he was actually a prisoner. He was taken by the Japanese to he was taken by the Japanese as a prisoner, and he told gave them this idea. So he was on their whims and fancies. He could not dictate to the Japanese what to do. Now secondly, the thing is, second phase began with the Subhash Bose in Singapore. Now we remember that Raj Bihari Bose had fled to Japan in 1915 when he had failed the revolutionary activities. So he became an active Pan-Asian, active in Pan-Asian circles, founded the Indian Club of Tokyo, and gave lectures on the evils of Western imperialism. When the Indian National Army was formed by Mohan Singh in Singapore, what happened after this? Raj Bihari left for Southeast Asia. As soon as Raj Bihari got to know that Mohan Singh has formed the Indian National Army, he went there straight away. It was decided to place the INA under Indian Independence League, whose chairman would be Raj Bihari Bose. So it was decided that now the leader will be Raj Bihari Bose. And when Subhash Bose came to Japan to lead the INA, Raj Bihari Bose readily gave the ownership on the control of the Indian Independence League and the INA to Subhash Bose. So basically Mohan Singh made the Indian Army, Indian National Army. Then Raj Bihari Bose went to Southeast Asia. He formed the Indian Independence League. The league will be controlling the army. And then Subhash Bose went there. He was controlling both the Indian Independence League and the Indian National Army. So Subhash Bose formed the Provisional Government for Free India at Singapore with H.C. Chatterjee with the finance portfolio, M.A. Iyer broadcasting, Lakshmi Swaminathan Women Department. He gave the slogan, "Give me blood and I shall give you freedom." This provisional government declared war on the Britain and the US and was recognized by the Axis powers. Axis power means Germany, Japan and all. Now the headquarter was shifted to Rangoon, and the army recruits were to march from there with a war cry, "Chalo Delhi." On November 6, Andaman and Nicobar were given by the Japanese army to INA. So basically, they had captured us till they had come till Andaman and Nicobar. The islands were renamed by the army to Shahid Dweep and Swaraj Dweep. Now Subhash Bose addressed Mahatma Gandhi as the father of the nation from the Azad Hind Radio. He asked for Gandhi's blessings for India's last war of independence. One INA battalion commanded by Shah Nawaz was allowed to accompany the Japanese to the Indo-Burma front and participate in the Imphal campaign. So this is what is happening, that Shah Nawaz, the people and the men under Shah Nawaz will go to Imphal with the British, with the Japanese, and they will attack India. So the Azad Hind Fauj crossed the Burma border and stood on the Indian soil. The units advanced up to Kohima and Imphal. So basically they did enter into India, they did capture a lot of territory. And on April 14, Colonel Malik of the Bahadur group hoisted the INA flag for the first time on the Indian mainland in Moirano. Now basically on August 15, 1945, Japan surrendered and the Second World War took place. And with this, the INA also surrendered. So basically now when Japan is surrendering, and the INA was a unit in this, so they also had to surrender. But when the INA prisoner of wars were brought back to India after the war, a powerful movement emerged in their defense. So they were basically Indians were very angry with the British when they started, they tried to persecute the Indian National Army. Now this chapter is over, and I'll be waiting for your doubts for 1 or 2 minutes. Okay, so Shreya is asking, why was Desai called political pariah? See, Shreya, I have no idea regarding this. I'll have to check and get back to you. So I'll tell you in the group or in the next class. I have no idea regarding this. And I want to ask something, is this subtitles which are coming below the video, are they proper or are they missing in between? Because this has been specifically put up to help those who are not Now I'll be starting with the next chapter. Okay, Tanya is saying they are missing in between. Okay. So chapter 24, post-war national scenario. So now according to this, the war has ended and the World War II has ended. And what will happen after this war? So now two strands of national upsurge. Now two strands means that two things will happen now. Basically these two things will happen continuously till the time we get independence. There will be negotiations involving the government, Congress and the Muslim League, and sporadic, localized and militant mass actions by the worker peasants and states people. So now all the Indians are demanding freedom, and Congress, Muslim League and the British are negotiating as to how we will get the independence. So there were three violent revolutions: INA Release Movement, Royal Indian Revolt, Tebhaga Movement, Worli Revolt, Punjab Kisan Morcha, Travancore People's Struggle, etc. Now change in the government's attitude. So the reasons for the change were, with the end of the war, there was a change in global power. UK was no more a big power, while USA and USSR were the superpowers now, both of which favored freedom for India. So now UK was not the world leader as it used to be earlier. Now USA was the leader of the West and USSR was the leader of the socialist countries. So they decided that we will frame the world order now and not Britain. They demanded that India should be freed. So now both the powers, world powers, are saying this. So they had to free India now. The Labour government, which was formed now, was more sympathetic to the demands of Indians. Throughout Europe, there was a wave of socialist radical governments. So now socialism had also crept into Europe, and they also demanded that there should be freedom. Now British soldiers were very tired and the British economy was shattered. They could not continue to do all of these things, war and so. So this problem had started. There was an anti-imperialist wave in Southeast Asia, in Vietnam and Indonesia, resisting efforts to replant French and Dutch rule there. Now the Britishers were using Indian army to help the France and Dutch to get control over Vietnam and Indonesia. So this was also resisted by these people. Officials feared another Congress revolt, a revival of 1942 situation, but much more dangerous because of the combination of attacks on communications, agrarian revolts, labor, army disaffection joined by the government officials, and police in the presence of INA with some military experience. So the situation will be very explosive now, and elections were inevitable because once the war ended, last elections had been held in 1934 for center and 1937 for the provinces. So it had been more than 8 years that no elections had been held in India. Now Congress elections, campaign and INA trials. Now election campaign for nationalistic aims. They sought to mobilize Indians against the British, and it did not appeal for the votes. It expressed the national sentiments against state repression of 1942 upsurge, and this was done by glorifying the martyrs and condemning officials. This brave resistance of the leaderless people was lauded. Martyrs memorials were set up, relief funds were collected, the officials responsible for causing pain were condemned, and promises for inquiry and threats for the punishment to guilty officials were spelled out. So basically what is happening now, that the Congress is not afraid of the British anymore, and they also know that independence is actually won. So in this elections they will speak against the British, they will speak for the people, and they will tell the people that we will take strict action against all those officials who have stepped outside of their duty and killed those who were basically revolting. So this created a lot of fear in the minds of people who were working as government servants. So because the government failed to check such speeches, this had devastating effect on the morale of the services. There was mass pressure against the trial of Indian National Army prisoners of war, brought about a decisive shift in the government's policy. Now first trial, the first case had already been done, first stage. In this, at Red Fort, November 1945, they put on dock together a Hindu, Prem Kumar Sehgal, a Muslim Shah Nawaz Khan, and Sikh Gurbakhsh Singh Dhillon. Now, another issue was provided by the use of Indian Army to restore French and Dutch colonial rule in Vietnam and Indonesia, as I told you in the previous page. So now, here at Red Fort, what has happened is that they have taken a Muslim, Sikh, and a Hindu, and they are hanging them together. So this enhanced the anti-imperialist feeling and between the people and the army. Everybody started hating the Britishers now. Now, Congress support for the INA prisoners. A strong resolution was adopted by declaring the Congress support for the INA cause. Defense of INA prisoners was organized by Mulla Bhai Desai, Tej Bahadur Sapru, Kailash Nath Kadju, Jawaharlal Nehru, and Asaf Ali. INA Relief and Enquiry Committee distributed sums of money, food, and helped arrange employment for the affected. So now, INA agitation. INA agitation is basically the British is trying means they are putting to trial the INA prisoners of war, and the Indians are saying no, you should not do it. Now the campaign was spread over a wide area of the country and witnessed participation of diverse social groups and political parties. Even in the traditional bulwarks of the Raj, basically government employees also started speaking against the government now. They collected funds. The loyalists, the gentlemen with titles, appealed to the government to abandon the trials for good Indo-British relations. So now the Rajas and the princes, they also started telling the British that please do not carry on this, because India and British relations will spoil because of this. Men of the armed forces were sympathetic and attended meetings, received those often in uniforms, and contributed funds. So now the those who are serving in the British Indian Army, they are also receiving those people after the trial who were prisoners of war, even in their uniforms. That is against the army discipline, but still they are doing it. Now the theme behind this became, can Britain continue to decide a matter which is concerning Indians? Till how long will it continue? So it heightened the anti-British feeling in India, and all of these things were not acceptable to the British, to the Indians. Now Tanya is asking, why were the trials held at Red Fort? So basically the reason being that they wanted to carry out a public trial, and if you know that this is actually a fundamental right that public trials cannot be held. So because now they did it at Red Fort because Red Fort was the symbol of authority earlier, because the Mughals had Red Fort, so it was a symbol of their authority, and secondly they wanted to do it at a place which was significant and everybody could see properly. So Red Fort is a huge and a spacious place. Earlier it used to be a huge center of activity. Chandni Chowk, which is very crowded now as well, it was a major city and major point at that time. Now three upsurges. Now there were three movements in the winters of 1945 to 1946. In Calcutta over the INA trials, and in second was also in Calcutta over a 7-year sentence given to Rashid Ali. He was a officer in the basically INA officer. In February 18, 1946, there was a strike by the Royal Indian Navy ratings. Royal Indian Navy rating means the British Indian Navy. They started revolting. Now there was a three-stage pattern in all of these movements. In the first stage, people defied authority and it was repressed. So basically people were agitating and they were beaten up by the government. So now see, in the first instance, this is November 21 in Calcutta over the INA trials. This is basically an INA agitation. Now students were basically forward bloc sympathizers, Student Federation of India. They tied the League and Congress flags together as a symbol of anti-imperialist unity march. So these protesters refused to disperse and were lathi charged. They retaliated by throwing stones and brickbats. The police resorted to firing, in which two persons died. In the next step, the protest was led by Muslim League students. See here. In this case, See, basically now they are not telling the revolts individually. They are saying that in the first phase of this revolt, this happened. In the first phase of this revolt, this happened. So in the first phase where the people have started an agitation and they are being beaten up. So they are telling you in these three movements how they have been beaten up by the government. So in the first case where Kolkata agitation was going over for INA trials, the people were beaten up by the British and two persons died. Now in the second case, again for the Rashid Ali movement, the protesters were led by Muslim League students and some Congress also joined. So some arrests provoked the students to defy section 144. There were more arrests and agitating students were lathi charged. So in this also they were lathi charged. Now in the next issue, what is happening? The HMIS means it is the name of the ship. The ship is HMIS Talwar, went on a strike to protest against racial discrimination, unpalatable food, abuse by superiors, arrest of ratings for scrolling Quit India on the Talwar. Basically they have written on the ship, and INA trials, use of Indian troops in Indonesia and demanding their withdrawal. So they hoisted the tricolor, crescent and hammer and sickle flags, and other ratings soon joined them. So basically they started threatening Europeans and policemen, and they started revolting. So and they were also basically revolting against the INA, but they also had specific demands for the army persons. Now when the police people joined in, public people joined in the first three cases, again in the Kolkata INA agitation, in the Rashid Ali and in the HMIS Talwar agitation by Royal Indian Naval ratings, we have seen that there is a protest beginning, and we have seen what happened initially. In the second stage of all of them, there was paralysis of Kolkata and Bombay. All the people came out in support. And in the third stage, when the people in other parts expressed sympathy and solidarity. Now whenever this breaking of law and order, all of these things are happening, they are only receiving support from the other people. Okay, they are receiving support from all the other parts of the country, and they are being given sympathy. So this is what has happened. Now Patel and Jinnah persuaded the ratings to surrender with an assurance that national parties would prevent any victimization. Now what is the evaluation? Now there was fearless action by the masses, and revolt in the armed forces was a great liberating effect on the minds of people. So now the people had seen that the not only we are revolting, but the armed forces are also against the British rule. So it was seen as an event marking the end of British rule. These absurdities promoted the British to extend some concessions. So when so many revolt was going on and every section of the Indian society was against the British, and they either requested the British or revolted against the British to do something, so they said the following things: only those members accused of murder or brutal treatment will be brought to trial. So only those INA members who have either killed somebody or have done something heinous, they will be brought to trial. Now imprisonment sentences passed against the first batch were remitted. Indian soldiers were withdrawn from Indochina and the Indonesia by February 1947. So we had studied that to help the French and the Dutch, Indian army was being used. So they were also called back. The decision to send a parliamentary delegation was taken. So Britain will send a delegation to India, and this delegation will be called the Cabinet Mission. These upsurges were direct and violent conflict with the authority, which had limitations. Only the more militant sections could participate. So basically there are some people who are basically law abiding, so they did not go out, but only those people participated who could create mischief as well. The INA agitation reached the remotest villages. Communal unity witnessed was more organizational than unity among the people. Muslim ratings went to the League to seek advice, and the rest went to the Congress and the Socialists. Now what was the strategy of the Congress? Now Congress was indifferent to what was going on because of two things: that the situation would go out of control if they started a movement again, and a disciplined armed forces were vital for free India. So now Congress decided that we will not allow the army to revolt, because this army will become the Indian army, the army of free India. And if this convention of revolting against the government is continued, then tomorrow this will become very dangerous for the security and stability of the country. So we will not support the armed forces. Now election results. Congress got 91% of non-Muslim votes and captured 57 out of 102 votes in the Central Assembly. In the provincial elections, it got majority in the provinces except Bengal, Sindh and Punjab. The Congress majority provinces included NWFP and Assam, which were being claimed for Pakistan. So now the League was asking for these areas in Pakistan. But actually what happened? On the ground, NWFP people voted for Congress rather than the Muslim League. And in Assam also, there was a demand to keep it in East Pakistan. But now that section has voted for Congress. Now Muslim League's performance, it got 86.6% of the Muslim votes and captured the 30 reserved seats in Central Assembly. The provincial elections, it got a majority in Bengal and Sindh. And unlike in 1937, it clearly established itself as the party of Muslims. Earlier elections, what happened was League was nowhere in the picture. It could not win even a single province. In Punjab, a unionist Congress Akali coalition under Khizr Hayat Khan assumed power. So here unionist party, Congress party and the Akali party in Punjab have come to power. Now significant features, there was sharp communal voting due to separate electorates and limited franchisee. So now only, I think only 10% of the population could vote, and for the Central Assembly, see, it is written 1% of the population was eligible. So it was very communal. Now the cabinet mission. Now it was written that after these RIN, Royal Indian Navy revolts and all of those things, the cabinet mission was sent to India. It had three members, Pathick Lawrence, Secretary of State of India Stafford Cripps and A.V. Alexander. So all of these three members came to India. Now why is the British withdrawal imminent now? Basically they can withdraw anytime. The success of the nationalist forces in the struggle for hegemony was evident. Now basically Indians have lost the fear of the British in their minds. They are now free within their minds. So now it is actually Indians are convinced that no British rule can continue in India anymore. Now there was a demonstration in favor of nationalism against the bureaucracy and loyalist sections, because there was a paucity of European ICS recruits and a policy of Indianization had ended the British domination. So now we remember that the Britishers had started a policy of bringing in Indians to the administration one by one, slowly and slowly bringing Indians into the administration. So this resulted in the basically now Indian administrations were more, Indian administrators were more. So this resulted in a loss of loyalty for the British. They all wanted India to be free. Now the British strategy of conciliation and repression had limitations and contradictions. So now basically this strategy which we have been studying, that there will be repression and conciliation. Moderates will be, extremists will be repressed and moderates will be given concessions. So now they had given everything, only independence was left to give. So see, after the Cripps offer, there was little left to offer except full freedom. When non-violent resistance was repressed with force, the naked force behind the government stood exposed. While if the government did not clamp down, it seemed unable to wield its authority. So in any case, even when the government started beating up the people, then the people got to know how bad the British were. And when it said that, no, we will not suppress you, then the people thought that, yes, we have attained freedom. So in either case, the British were unable to control the country. And efforts to woo the Congress dismayed the loyalists. So now when the other plans, basically after the war is over and the British has decided that we will give independence to India, So the thing has come out that the Britishers are giving a lot of preference to Congress over all the other groups. Earlier they were supporting those groups who were, they even cropped up the Muslim League. But now they were supporting the Congress more because they knew actually that the real representatives of Indians are Congress. Now Congress Raj had proved to be a big morale booster and helped in the deeper penetration of patriotic sentiments. Demands of leniency for INA prisoners from within the army and the revolt of RIN ratings had raised fears that the army forces may not be reliable if there was a movement again. Now this was also done for good British India and British and India relation. Now what was happening when the cabinet mission plan came to India? Now Congress demanded that the power be transferred to one center and minorities' demands be worked out in a framework ranging from autonomy to self-determination or secession, but after the British left. So basically they are saying that give us a single center right now, we will see what we will have to do with the minorities or the Muslim majority areas. Either we will give them autonomy or self-determination or even going out of the Indian Union, but before, it will not be before the British have left. The British policy reflected a preference for united India. Now cabinet mission arrived. Discussion with Indian leaders took place on the issue of interim government. Interim government before independence, the Indians will come to power and what will happen? How will they share the power? And procedure for framing a new constitution for free India. Now cabinet mission plan, it demanded the Pakistan because Pakistan would include large non-Muslim population, 38% in northwest and 48% in northeast, means 38% in Pakistan and 48% in the present Bangladesh. Now partition would entail economic and administrative problems, the problem of communication. So basically now they are saying if you want one country, how will you communicate with each other? So British are saying no, that cannot be done. And if we divide the armed forces between these two, it will be very difficult. So what they did, they grouped the provinces into three types. Section A, Madras, Bombay, all of those areas where Hindus were in majority. Section B is Muslim majority provinces in the western part. And Section C is Muslim majority provinces in the eastern part. Now they said that a constituent assembly, we will be making a constituent assembly, which will be elected by provincial assemblies. So basically these three are the provincial assemblies, a group, this is a group, and they individually had provincial assemblies by proportional representation voting in three groups. So now basically individual units from this Madras, Bombay, central provinces, united provinces, all of them will vote and elect the constituent assembly, and they will vote in three groups. Generals will vote, Muslims will vote, and Sikhs will vote separately. So this is what will happen, and they will elect the constituent assembly. After that, in the constituent assembly, members from the groups A, B, C, so these groups, members from the groups were to sit separately. Now members from Madras, Bombay, UP, Bihar, they will sit in one group. Section B and Section C, all of these three will sit separately now, and they decide the constitution for the provinces and for the groups as well. So they will make the constitution for each of the province, each of the group, and then the whole constituent assembly would sit together and formulate the union constitution. So basically there will be three constitutions according to this. So three in the sense ki three types. One will be a constitution for province, then there will be a constitution for this section basically, which is called a group, and third there will be a constitution for the union. Okay, then all of these three, after they will have made individual constitutions, the group constitution, then they will sit together and make for the union. It said that there will be a common center which will control defense, communication and external affairs, and there will be a federal structure. Provinces will have full autonomy and residual powers. So basically today we have a very centralized constitution. The powers are leaning towards the center. We had studied in polity as well that we have a federation with a leaning tendency towards the center. But the cabinet mission plan said that India and Pakistan basically will be a single country. There will be separate constitution for each province. The residuary power will also be given to it. They will be autonomous, and there will be a center which will only control defense, communication and external affairs. Now, provinces were to have full autonomy and residual power. Princely states were no longer to be paramounts of the British. They would be free to enter into arrangement with the successor government or the British. So this thing, if you see that regarding the princely states, they are saying that either they can go to the British or they can remain free, or they can go with the government which is there in India. So after the first general election, a province was to be free to come out of a group, and after 10 years a province was to be free to call for a reconsideration of the group or a union constitution. So basically when 10 years will be over, so this group which had been made here, see for example Assam will be in this. So now if Assam wants to come out of this group, it can come out of 10 years. So, and if it wants to change the union constitution, it can change after 10 years. So this is what it is saying here. A province was to be come out of the group after 10 years and free for consideration of the group or the union constitution. So basically they are saying that after 10 years what will happen, they can come out of the group. So basically now they can also become free after 10 years. So this is basically a very divisive tactic by the Britishers, that they are dividing into India into so many pieces after 10 years that it will lead to balkanization. Balkanization means cutting it into small pieces. Meanwhile, an interim government was to be formed by the Constituent Assembly. Now, different interpretation of the grouping clause. Congress said that grouping was optional and one Constituent Assembly was envisaged, and the League no longer had a veto. So now, regarding these provisions, what Nehruji is saying, or the Congress is saying, that these groups which are formed, this is just optional. So the main thing is that there is to be a single Constituent Assembly. So Congress is thinking that this is the point, but Muslim League is saying that no, there, see, this is saying that Pakistan is specifically given in this. Now the League's understanding was correct. So as I told you na, that it had given options to make, and after 10 years every group could go out and all those things. So basically the League was thinking in these lines, and the mission said that yes, the League is thinking in correct lines. So what were the objections? Congress is saying that the provinces should not have to wait for the first general election to come out of a group. They should have the option of not joining the group. Basically, he is saying that they should have the option of making the union constitution and agreeing with it specifically. Why should we make groups? Now, compulsory grouping contradicts the insistence of provincial autonomy. He is saying that if they are actually autonomous, if the provinces are autonomous, why do you want to make them into groups? Absence of provision for elected members from the princely states. He is saying that those who are from the princely states, why are they not given a chance to get elected to the Constituent Assembly? Now, League is saying that the grouping should be compulsory, with section B and C developing into solid entities to succeed into Pakistan. Now, exception and rejection. The Muslim League on June 6 and the Congress on June 24 accepted the long-term plan. Nehru said that we are not bound by single thing except that we have decided to go into the Constituent Assembly and there will be no grouping. So this is actually, he was saying that NWFP and Assam will not be in the group B and C. There will be no grouping and we will form the constitution according to our wishes. So as soon as he said this on July 10, the Muslim League is now angry. The League is saying we will not accept this plan because of Nehru's statement and we will take up direct action. So now direct action means we will be launching a movement for Pakistan. So now there was, in this between, there was a Wavell's breakdown plan. This plan envisaged the withdrawal of British Army and officials from the Muslim provinces of NWFP, Northwest and Northeast, and handing over the rest of the country to the Congress. So now basically he is saying that the British Army will leave every area except the Muslim dominated areas, and they basically, now the British had understood that they cannot suppress another revolt which is started by the Congress. So now what they have done is they are thinking that we will control Pakistan and Bangladesh and give freedom to India. Now this is basically desire of the high official circles to make Northern Ireland of Pakistan. So basically there is in the United Kingdom some area of Ireland, Northern Ireland. So this is what they wanted to do with this part as well. So this was the plan. Now communal Holocaust. Now Muslim League has given a direct action day. So now they are asking for Pakistan and they will launch a movement. If we do not get Pakistan, we will revolt. This is what Jinnah is saying. So communal Holocaust and the interim government. From August 16, the Indian scene was rapidly transformed. There were communal riots and left several thousands dead. Changed government priorities. Now Wavell was eager to somehow get the Congress into the interim government, even if the League stayed out. Now this is because they want to leave the country now, and they know that Congress is the real representative. So now they were fearing a mass action by the Congress. So they said that the League has also launched a movement, and if the Congress are not given any power now, then they will launch a movement. So now the Britishers thought that the Congress will launch a movement, and then what will we do? All the Britishers will be killed by the army, Indian people. So they brought in a Congress-dominated government headed by Nehru, and Nehru continuing to insist on his party's opposition to compulsory grouping. So even then, Nehru was allowed to continue. Wavell also brought the Muslim League after basically 1 month, 1.5 months. The League was allowed to join without giving up direct action. He said, okay, you continue to do that, whatever you are doing. Then, despite rejection of the cabinet mission's long-term and short-term plans, it refused the cabinet mission plan and it insisted upon compulsory grouping. So now basically Congress is also a part of this interim government, Muslim League is also a part, and both of them are not agreeing with each other, but they are part of this government. So you know that it will not function properly. But these are the persons. See, this is Jawaharlal Nehru, who was Vice President of the Council, External Affairs and Commonwealth Relations were under him. Vallabh Bhai Patel, Sardar Patel had home and information broadcasting. And in this, Dr. Rajendra Prasad is important. Another thing is Liaquat Ali Khan was holding the finance portfolio. So now this will create a huge issue because finance was under Liaquat Ali Khan and police was under Sardar Patel. Now Sardar Patel was looking for funds to carry out to quell the communal riots, but Liaquat Ali Khan was so clever, he did not release the funds to the police, and they were not able to stop the communal riots. And Sardar Patel had to face the backlash so that he is not able to control the riots. So they were very smart in their tactics. Now obstructionist approach and ulterior motives of the League. Now the League started attending the government, but they did not attend the Constituent Assembly. They refused to attend the meetings of the cabinet decisions. They questioned the decisions and appointments made by the Congress. Liaquat Ali Khan restricted the efficient functioning of other ministries. So that is what I was telling you, that he stopped giving them money. The League had only sought a foothold in the government to fight for Pakistan. For them, it was a continuation of the civil war by other means. In February 1947, the nine Congress members wrote to the Viceroy demanding resignation of the League members and threatening withdrawal of their own nominees. The last straw came with the League demanding dissolution of the Constituent Assembly. So now, whatever progress has been made till now, the League is saying now we do not want this Constituent Assembly. The Congress is saying now that either you take these people out of the government or we will launch a campaign. Now, this situation you must remember that till now we have reached here. Okay, so after this, you can see what were the reasons of birth and spread of communalism in India. So, now characteristic features of Indian communalism. Now, this is extremely important to understand. This is important for society. This is also important for mains. This you can understand here. Now, basically, communalism is an ideology which gives more importance to one's own ethnic or religious group rather than the wider society. Basically, whenever I am giving more preference to my religion or any of my collective identity, it may be ethnicity or any other thing. Communalism is in India is mostly associated with religion, but communalism basically is derived from community. So communal means you are giving more preference to your community. It can be a linguistic community as well, it can be a racial community as well, or any other community. Even on the basis of caste, it is known as communalism. But in India, it is specifically focusing on religion because of so many riots which we had before independence. Now, communal nationalism, there are three stages of communalism. First is communal nationalism. This is basically people who are belonging to that same community start developing a sense that they are one. So this is saying, this is a notion, section of people belonging to a particular community, their secular interests are also the same. So basically kind of thing is that if a person belongs to this religion, a religion, then he will like X book. All of the persons from a religion write like X book. It may be a novel, for example, any novel you can take. They are considering that all of us like the same things, all of us like to vote for the same person, all of us like to have hospitals, all of us like to have this, that. We will be demanding same things. So this is what they think. Second is liberal communalism. Since two communities have different religious interests, they also have different interests in the secular sphere. So basically I told you that community A likes book X. So now they are thinking that because community A, for example, I am in community A and you are community B, I like book X. It is a normal book, it is not Gita or Quran, it is a normal book. So I am saying now to all of my followers that because we like book A, book X, you people, you, those who are watching me, group B, you cannot like that book because you and I are different. So this thing is that in the communal nationalism, first stage, what happens is that people who are from the same group consider that all of their interests outside of their religious sphere are same. Second stage is what is happening is that not only those who are in the group have same interest, but those who are from other groups will always have a divergent interest. They can never have the same interest as mine. And the third is extreme communalism, that not only different communities have different interests, but they are incompatible. So now basically the thing I am thinking is that I like book X and you like books Y, and if you get book Y, I will not get book X. So I am instigating my people that see, we should not let them have book Y so that there can be only book X which is prevailing in the country. So it is not giving any due regard to the individuality of the person or to the locality of the person. It is completely subverting an individual into group identity and not giving any regard to his or her personal opinion. Now, if this is clear, please tell me down, write down in the comment section. If this is not clear, because this is important, I'll explain again. Okay. So this is the basic thing of nationalism. First will be communal nationalism, where a whole community decides that we are one. In the second stage is happening is not only we are one and they are different from us. In the third stage, what is happening is that their benefit is our loss. So these are the three stages. Okay, Tanya is saying it is clear. Now, see, I told you that they bypass the individual interests altogether. They bypass the basic economic interests. The communalists claim to protect the interests which do not necessarily exist. So now, basically, the thing is that communalists in extreme communalism, they are promoting that probably if a Hindu gets job, he is taking the job of a Muslim. But that may not be the correct thing. So now, if a Hindu gets a school, they will say that it is not good for the Muslim, but that is not true. Because if a school is made, everybody can enjoy the benefits of the school. And it is an economic interest, it is a social interest of everybody. So they overlook those things. I'm not saying that you overlook or I overlook. I am saying that there are some sections who spread hatred because of these things and gain undue advantage in the society. They get an undue advantage. they spread rumors and they spread this mindset in the society that it is basically a politics of fear, a politics of hatred, and a politics of identity. And in this politics of identity, your individual interests will be gone away. They will not even be considered. The only interest which you will have left is that the other community does not benefit, even if it is at your own cost. Now, communalism is a modern phenomena rooted in the modern social, economic, and political colonial structure that emerged out of the modern politics based on mass mobilization and popular participation. Now, they are saying that it is a modern phenomena because that we now require votes. So we need to mobilize people to give votes to the leader. And this has become more and more popular because now people are demanding votes. Some people will have an image that if I am elected, I will benefit this religion. So this is used a lot and this is a modern feature. Its social roots lay in the rising middle class who propagated imaginary communal interests to further their own economic interests. So basically, if I am a Hindu and I exclude Muslims from getting a job which I want, so the competition will reduce. So that is how it is starting. And the middle class, rising middle class, who is looking for better opportunities to work. So what they try to do is that they know that the number of seats are fixed. So I will exclude some persons of the other caste. They were backed by the colonial administration. It was the channel through which colonialists expanded their social base. Now, British are looking for allies. Allies means supporters of the British rule in India. And how did they get it? By giving them benefits. And how did they give benefits? For example, special electorates, giving them special reservation in jobs. So they used all of these tactics to help people to support the British rule and deny the existence of India as a nation, or basically denying the people of India to come together. Often socio-economic distinctions in Indian society coincided with religious distinctions. The inherent class contradictions were given a post-facto communal coloring by the vested interest. So basically the problem was that the education among the lower castes were less, education among the Muslims were less. So this gave a possible hotbed to the Britishers that they could see all of these things, and they also realized that see, the Muslims are lagging behind in government jobs. Hindus are getting more government jobs. So let us go and sign a pact with them that we will give you this job and you do not support the Congress. So they used this. And why were the reason? What were the reasons? Socio-economic reasons. See, modern Western thought and scientific ideas were not absorbed by the Muslim intellectuals who retained traditional and backward things. Okay. The Muslims did not adopt the scientific ideas and Western thought as fast as the Hindus did. The proportion of educated was far lower among the Muslims than among the Hindus, Parsis, or the Christians. The Muslims also lagged behind in the growth of trade and industry. The educated Muslim found few opportunities in business or professions. They looked for government employment. British officials and the loyalist Muslims incited the educated Muslims against the Hindus. So this was the problem, and this was the main reason why this developed. And because of the economic backwardness of India and unemployment, there was scope for the Britishers to use concessions, favors, and reservations to fuel communal and separatist tendencies. Also, modern political consciousness was late in developing among the Muslims, and the dominance of traditional reactionary elements over the Muslim masses helped a communal outlook to take roots. Now, there was a specific first thing was that social conditions were such that this happened. Second thing was British followed a definite policy of divide and rule. Now, Muslims were generally looked upon with suspicion initially. But after the Wahhabi and 1857 revolt, they were repressed by the British and discriminated by the British. Also, English had been introduced, which undermined Arabic and Persian learning, which added to the economic backwardness and exclusion of Muslims from service. So now basically this, the main reason for Muslims to not to take up this was that they did not take up the Western education because they always thought that they will be able to take back the empire again. Muslims, Mughals were basically Muslims. So they had their own government services and they thought that we will teach Persian and Arabic. So what happened was the Mughals were against the British rule. So they thought that today or tomorrow or later we will be able to throw the British off. But that never came. But the Hindus who were actually when the Mughal rule started, then also Hindus took employment under the Mughals. Now British rule had started, so they will quickly change their tactics and get a government job by any means, whether under the Mughals or under the British. So because right now the Britishers were the government, so they started learning English and the Western ideas and they got government jobs faster than the Muslims got, because they did not take up the Western ideas. They thought that we are equal to the Britishers. We are also kings. Why should we listen to these officials? Officials were nominated by the queen. They were not the queen or the king of Britain. But these princes were at one time kings or princes. It was only later on that they lost to the British. And then, so most of the kings in India at that time were Muslims. So they did not take up the education. For them, taking the education which the British said was a kind of a defeat, so they did not take it. So regarding this, the whole situation began. So when the Britishers came into India, there was a revolt of 1857, and in the revolt of 1857 the leader appointed was Bahadur Shah, and this made the British think that all of these conspiracy has been made by Muslims. So they initially demoted the Muslims. They did not take Muslims into jobs and all. But later, after 1870s, when the Hindus were educated and they took up Western ideas, and the birth of nationalism took place within the Hindu community. So then what happened? There was Indian nationalism and growing politicization of the educated middle classes. The government reversed its policy of repression of Muslims and decided to rally them and through concessions, favors and reservation, and use them against the nationalist forces. So basically we remember Sayyid Ahmad Khan, he also used to tell the Muslims that first you should take up jobs, become educated, and then after that you can join the nationalist movement. But later on he was such a loyalist of the British that he started instigating people against the Congress. Now, communalism in history writing. The communal interpretation of Indian history portrayed as the ancient phase as the Hindu phase and medieval phase as the Muslim phase. So basically during the national movements what happened was people started looking at the past to gain some self-respect, because the British said that you are an inferior race. So all of the self-respect of Indians were lost. So the Muslims started looking at the era of the Mughals and the Western Asia, the rule of the Turks and the Afghans, as the time when they were also in power. Hindus started looking at the time of ancient India where they could have huge empires like the Mauryan Empire or the Gupta Empire. So they started looking at both of their things for self-respect at different areas. So this will basically start a problem. The Hindu communal view of history chose to project the view that Indian society and culture reached the ideal heights in the ancient period, and it started decaying in the medieval period because of the Muslim rule. Now, there were some side effects of the social religious reform movement as well. We studied that there was Wahhabi movement among the Muslims and Shuddhi among the Hindus. The revivalists were very particular. Arya Samaj, the Anand Saraswati, they started a movement that we will bring back those who have converted. So the same thing was started by the Muslims. So it developed a communal consciousness among the people. Now there were side effects of militant nationalism as well. Tilak used Ganpati and Shivaji festivals, anti-cow slaughter campaigns, all of these things. So you know what these things are. Basically we have studied these things. So these things brought in the sign of communalism. Now the communal element in the Lucknow Pact, Khilafat agitation, was having far-reaching consequences. Now the heroes and myths and the cultural traditions of the Muslims belong to the, not to the history of India, but to the history of West Asia. So because of their cultural upbringing, they started looking at the West Asia as their actual root. So this made a major problem. Now because the Hindus were getting organized, they were organizing festivals and all of those things. So the Muslims also thought that we should also be organized. And because Tilak is using Ganpati festival, Shivaji festival, all of those things. So now the Muslims also have their own set of important festivals. A Hindu will not attend the Muslim festivals and Muslim will not attend the Hindu festivals, because there is a clear division, there is a clear conflict, not conflict there, but yes, it is a cultural difference. I may not want to go and attend another religion's festival. It is my personal choice and nobody can force me, because it is a fundamental right as well. So this thing started creating more and more problems. And when they were demanding things from the British, now for example, when the Tilak is using the Ganpati festival, so they will think that when the Britishers will be gone, and because they are using Ganpati, Shivaji and those festivals, so they will think, the Muslims will think that as soon as the Britishers will leave, there will be a Hindu rule and they will not allow us to celebrate our festivals. Something might of that sort may occur. Today the Britishers are giving us some concessions. Tomorrow when the Hindu rule will start, will we get the same concessions? So these problems starting emerging. Now communal reaction by the majority. Now because Muslims were afraid initially, they went to the British and made the Muslim League. So now the Hindu also thought that if they can take these things, why should we not take? Now this is a reaction by the majority community. Some Hindu zamindars and money lenders began to give expression to anti-Muslim sentiments. They went to declaring the British rule liberated the land from the Muslim rule and save Hindus from the oppression by Muslims. The Punjab Hindu Sabha, founded by U.N. Mukherjee and Lal Chand, opposed the Congress for trying to unite Indians into a single nation. They said that why are you uniting us into a single nation? But we are not a single nation, we are different nations. Then All India Hindu Mahasabha under the Maharaja of Qasim Bazar and Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh was established in 1925. Hindu communalism was not a strong force for a long time, as the modern secular intelligentsia and middle class among the Hindus wielded a greater influence. This was not the case with the Muslims. The initial leadership of the Hindu middle class is the Congress. Congress is basically educated and one with modern ideas. But if you see at the initial leadership of the Muslims, even during the anti-partition movement of Bengal, British cropped up Nawab Salimullah of Dhaka to brought up against the Congress. So they remained the traditional leaders of the Muslims, and the Muslim leaders in the initial part were traditional, whereas the Hindu leaders in that initial part were very modern. Even if you look at the social reform movements, Rajaram, it began with Rajaram Mohan Roy, and it was for a reform of the society. But if you look at the social reform movement of the Muslims, there is a thing for calling for the purity of Islam. More of them are related to that. So there is a kind of a difference. Okay. Now evolution of the two nation theory. In 1887, Syed Ahmad Khan and Raja Shiv Prasad were propped up as anti-Congress front, and Syed Ahmad Khan appealed to the educated Muslim to stay away from the Congress. Now Aga Khan led the Muslim delegation to the Viceroy to demand for separate electorates for Muslim. The All India Muslim League was founded by Aga Khan, Nawab Salimullah, see his name has come, I was telling you this person only, and Nawab Mohsinul Mulk and Waqarul Mulk to preach loyalty to the British government and to keep the Muslim intelligentsia away from the Congress. So now all of these people who have been propped up by the British, they will definitely not be those who want better for the Muslims. They are just a section of the elites in the Muslim society. They do not want, the Britishers have no interest in bringing you good things to India. They just want to rule over you, and they will bring the most reactionary elements from your society. In 1909, they awarded the separate electorates to the Muslims. British gave them the separate electorates. And then Punjab Hindu Sabha, we saw it was set up in 1915. Punjab Hindu Sabha was made up एंड फर्स्ट सेशन ऑफ द ऑल इंडिया हिंदू महासभा वॉज हेल्ड अंडर महाराजा ऑफ कासिम बाजार. सो दिस इज द रिएक्शन बाय द मेजोरिटी कम्युनिटी. मुस्लिम लीग वॉज डोमिनेटेड बाय द यंगर नेशनलिस्ट बट देयर नेशनलिज्म वॉज इंस्पायर्ड बाय अ कम्युनल व्यू. सो वी सी दिस ही इज टॉकिंग अबाउट द दोज इशूज. सी वी सॉ एट दिस टाइम दैट दे वर डिनाइड द अलीगढ़ यूनिवर्सिटी राइट्स टू सेटअप अ यूनिवर्सिटी एट अलीगढ़. सेकेंड थिंग वॉट हैपन्ड वॉज दे वर इन द वर्ल्ड वॉर वन दे वॉन्टेड लीनियंट ट्रीटमेंट टू द खलीफा एंड द खिलाफत मूवमेंट ऑल्सो. दे डेवलप्ड द नेशनलिस्ट व्यू दैट वी विल आउस्ट द ब्रिटिश फ्रॉम इंडिया बट दैट वॉज ऑल इंस्पायर्ड बाय कॉम्युनल इवेंट्स. सो दिस इज वॉट इट इज सेइंग. दे इन 1916 कांग्रेस एक्सेप्टेड दैट मुस्लिम लीग्स डिमांड ऑफ सेपरेट इलेक्ट्रेट्स एंड 1920-22 मुस्लिम्स पार्टिसिपेटेड इन द खिलाफत नॉन कॉपरेशन मूवमेंट. नाउ ड्यूरिंग दिस टाइम द आर्य समाजीज स्टार्टेड द शुद्धि मूवमेंट. सो द मुस्लिम्स ऑल्सो स्टार्टेड तबलीग एंड तंजीम मूवमेंट इन रिटेलिएशन. द स्वराजिस्ट वर डिवाइडेड ऑन द कम्युनल लाइन्स एंड जॉइंड द हिंदू महासभा. रिस्पॉन्सिविस्ट जॉइंड द हिंदू महासभा. सो नाउ स्वराजिस्ट वी रिमेंबर दैट देर वॉज अ स्वराजिस्ट पार्टी विच डिसाइडेड टू कंटेस्ट द इलेक्शंस एंड विद इन वाइल स्टेइंग विद इन द कांग्रेस इट डिसाइडेड टू कंटेस्ट द इलेक्शंस. सो देयर वाइल दे वर वर्किंग इन द काउंसिल्स दे वर क्लोजली एबल टू सी दैट द मुस्लिम लीग इज ड्राइविंग मेनी बेनिफिट्स बिकॉज ऑफ बींग क्लोजर टू द ब्रिटिशर्स. सो नाउ स्टॉन्च हिंदूज विद इन द स्वराजिस्ट started thinking that why should we not take the benefits also, why should we not support the British. Now this division between the Hindus and the Muslim was taken basically exploited by the Britishers. Now we remember that when the Nehru report was there, Jinnah proposed 14 points. He was adamant, see I will not accept this constitution until they are given. Now by negotiating with the League, Congress made a number of mistakes. It gave legitimacy to the politics of the League and giving recognition to the division of society into separate community with separate interests. Now, had they said that these rights, which are fundamental rights and economic program, everything which the Congress is saying, it is applicable to each and every person of the country. So they should have not negotiated with the Muslim League at that time. It undermined the role of secular and nationalist Muslims. See now, Muslim League at that time was not so popular as it became in 1946. So at this time there was a very major part of Muslims which were in the Congress as well. It did not take their opinion. Why was the Congress actually, see Congress is having self-doubt whether is it representing the Muslims or not. If there was no self-doubt and they would have felt with conviction that yes we are doing good for the Muslims as well, then the situation could have been different. Now concessions to one community prompted other community to demand similar concessions. And launching an all-out attack on communalism became difficult. Now, in 1932-34, now Muslims started their participation in the civil disobedience movement was less, and Congress stayed away from the roundtable conferences. And in these roundtable conferences was the plan which made the 1935 Government of India Act. And all of these conferences were attended by the communalists. So they got the separate electorates more and more. This brought more communalism into India. Earlier it was only Hindu-Muslim. Now all the sections are divided. Now after 1937 the Muslim League performed badly and it decided to resort to extreme communalism. Till now the stage of communalism in the Muslim League was the second stage, which was the liberal communalism. Now they decided that if we will keep soft in our promotion of Muslim interests, the Muslims will not rally behind us, we will not get their votes. So the idea of a separate Muslim nation was proposed by Muslim intellectual Rehmat Ali and developed by poet Iqbal. So now the Muslim League has decided that we will become very strict and we will not listen to the Congress and we will demand those things which are actually earlier not demanded. We will start demanding a new nation. So with the increasing radicalization, the reactionary elements stirs for a social base through the channels of communalism. The colonial administration has exhausted all means to divide the nationalists. Earlier failures to challenge communal tendencies had emboldened the communal forces. So now communal forces are thinking that because nobody has stopped us till now, nobody can stop us. Now in 1937 to 1939, Jinnah blocked all avenues for conciliation with the Congress, and it said that Congress should declare itself as a Hindu organization. March 24, we saw that when the World War started, he passed the Pakistan resolution. During the Second World War, British government gave a virtual veto to the League on Political Settlement. So whenever there was a settlement for the new constitution, the British always supported the Muslim League. So this chapter is also over, and if there are doubts, you can ask. Otherwise, I'll begin with this chapter. Or if you want, I can end the class right now also, because it has become a bit long. If it is comfortable with you, I will continue. This chapter will hardly take 20 minutes. So if it is comfortable with you, we will continue, or we can do it tomorrow as well. So shall I continue with the next chapter, or you want it to be done tomorrow? Or you can write down the doubts as well if you have any. Okay, so I will continue. There is a consensus to start with this chapter. So now in this chapter, there will be independence granted to India. Now see, the Britishers are fed up with Indians at this point of time. Earlier they were dividing the Indians. When they were deciding to leave, okay, they thought that now we are going, so we should keep a united India. So it is better that we keep one country. And secondly, they thought that the Congress is actually the real representative, and they started ignoring the Muslim League. But what did the Muslim League do? That it torpedoed the interim government that was formed. We have studied till now, but we started studying communalism in between. So this is a major problem with this book, that in between it breaks a lot of things. So I am just making you remember what happened. See, interim government was formed. Liaquat was made the finance minister. The finance minister stopped the home ministry from stopping the riots which were going on in India. So the riots began more and more and more. Half of the government is trying to stop the riots. Finance minister is trying that the riots are not controlled. Half of the government is trying that, basically the Muslim League is trying that the riots are continued and our demand for direct action will continue. So they said that we will not settle down for anything less than a Pakistan. We will not let you make your constitution until and unless you give us Pakistan. So now Attlee has given the statement. Now British are confused in this, what should we do? We want to go back, and they are fighting. So sensing the trouble, he made an announcement. Now main points of the Attlee statements. He is saying, now basically look at this irony. Earlier the Britishers wanted to stay in India, and we were saying go back. And now they want to go back. We are asking them to stay because Indians are not able to take care of the communal situation. Now, a deadline of 30 June 1948 was fixed for the transfer of power, even if the Indian politicians did not agree. So he is saying that I will give you independence on this date, and whosoever wants to take it alone or in a group or in as a province or as a princely state, however you want it, you can take. So British would relinquish power either to some form of central government or some areas or any provincial government if the Constituent Assembly was not fully representative. So British powers and obligations with the princely state would lapse, but these would not be transferred to any successor government. So basically they are saying that our rule over the princely states will end, but we will not be giving it to any successor government. So basically princely states are free, princes are free, not the people of the states, but the princes are free to do anything, and Mountbatten will become the new viceroy. Now basically it is a plan of balkanization of the country into numerous states, and basically a reversion of the Cripps offer. Even the Cripps offer is not being taken into consideration now. Now why is the date being fixed? The government had hoped that a fixed date would shock the parties into an agreement on the main question, and the government was keen to avert the developing constitutional crisis. It hoped to convince the Indians of the British sincerity. Now what is the British trying to do? They are saying that I am going now, whether you want it or not, I am going, because now the Britishers know that if we will stay in the country, next thing what will happen is the Muslim League will not stop, the Congress will launch another movement, and what will happen? The Britishers will be killed there. So what is the use of staying there? Let us go out, let us say that we are going, you handle your matters on your own, we will not interfere. So this is the stand of the British. Now Congress has said that the provision of transfer of power to more than one centre was acceptable because it meant the existing assembly could go ahead and frame the constitution as represented by it. So basically now what Congress is thinking, here it is written that it will relinquish power to some form of central government or other areas. So now wherever Congress is in power, it is mostly in power in all the areas, and it is not in power only, even it is in power in NWFP and Assam. So the British are thinking, so the Congress is thinking, so it's okay, now we will make the constitution, and the center will be with us, and we will get the power from the British. So the Congress is thinking in this, on these lines. So it thought that it is good, that it's okay, that now the Muslims can form their own constitution, we will make our own constitution and we will do it. Now the League is agitated because of this. The League launched a civil disobedience movement to throw the coalition government in Punjab, as it left emboldened by the statement. Now in Punjab there was a unionist, Akali and Congress government in power, but the League had major support in that area. Now what is happening is, this has basically struck fear in the Muslims. See that the Britishers are going, and see right now we are under a rule which is not of Muslims. So the Muslim League called for a, and there are all around the country there are communal rights going on. So in Punjab it launched a civil disobedience movement to throw out the Sikh and the Congress power, from power. So now independence and partition. In April 1947, the Congress president said that rather than have a battle, we shall let them have their own Pakistan, provided you allow Bengal and Punjab to be partitioned in the fair manner. So now in Punjab also there were Sikhs and Hindus. Basically Punjab was much bigger than it is today. Half of Punjab was in Pakistan. Basically a smaller portion of Punjab is in India. Punjab in Pakistan is a bit bigger than what we have in India. So now the Congress said that it will create a ruckus in the country, it will create a lot of problems, let us let them have this Pakistan and we shall protect our own people. Now Mountbatten was the viceroy, and he was asked by the British that we have to leave very fast so you can do whatever you want to, okay. So he had a lot of powers. On June 3 he gave his plan. He said that immediate transfer of power will be given with dominion status. So now Indians who were earlier demanding independence, Nehru was saying that I will not take anything less than independence, now is settling for a dominion status. And basically the reason for this will be that immediately we will get the dominion status and we will be able to control the situation. But you must see that how politicians act. Main points. The plan was that Punjab and Bengal Legislative Assembly will meet in two groups, Hindus and Muslims, to vote for the partition. If a simple majority of either groups voted for the partition, then these provinces would be partitioned. So now Hindus will meet differently, separately, and the Muslims will meet separately in Bengal and Punjab. And if either of them say in a simple majority, so basically definitely there is going to be a partition. In case of partition, two dominions and two constituent assemblies will be created. Sindh will take its own decision. Referendums in NWFP and Sylhet would decide the fate of these areas. So basically Sindh, NWFP and Sylhet of Bengal, which is basically in the Bangladesh now. So all of them will decide on their own. Now since Congress has conceded a unified India, now since because Congress has given up the demand for the whole of the thing which was earlier there, their demands will be met. Basically independence for the princely states will be ruled out. So now along with this, what the Congress said in this settlement was that let them have their Pakistan, but you will not allow princely states to be free. They will have to join either India or Pakistan. Secondly, independence for Bengal ruled out. Now Bengal, totally basically based on Bengali language, they would not be getting single country. Accession of Hyderabad to Pakistan ruled out. Now because Hyderabad, there is a Hyderabad in Pakistan as well, another one. But this Hyderabad which is there in India right now, in Andhra, that will remain with India. So Hyderabad is the name of the city, but Hyderabad was much bigger. It was a princely state. Now freedom to come on August 15, 1947 and boundary commission to set up if partition was to be effected. Now why the Congress has accepted dominion status now? We remember that in Lahore Congress session, Nehruji had said that we will not take anything less than Purna Swaraj. Now Congress is thinking that it will ensure peaceful and quick transfer of power. It was more important to assume authority to check the explosive situation. It would allow much needed continuity in the bureaucracy and the army. Now rationale for the early date. Now in the thing it was June 1948, but now they are saying we will go early. See, because they wanted to secure Congress agreement to the dominion status. At that time, the British could escape the responsibility for the communal situation. Now, Britishers are thinking, see, British was a major power at that time. Though it was not a superpower, it had an image to protect in the world. And in the world, its image was going that it is such a poor country. It has become so weak that it is not even to control an inferior race. We were still an inferior race for them, even though we are independent today. But there is still a mental superiority complex within the Goras or the whites. A feeling of superiority is still there. So at that time also it was there. Within one day they will not have thought that Indians are now fit to. Now basically what they are doing is you go to hell. We are going. So now they don't want any responsibility relating to India. They have looted us whatever they wanted. Now when the people of India are dying, they want to go back early. But Indians are asking them to stay. Now Indian Independence Act. On July 5, 1947, British Parliament passed the Indian Independence Act, which was based on this Mountbatten plan. The act provided for two independent dominions of India and Pakistan. Each will have a Governor General responsible for the effective operation for the act. So now the role of the Governor General is to make sure that this act is carried out properly. The Constituent Assembly will carry out the power of legislature of that dominion. While doing the making of the Constitution, we remember that the Constituent Assembly also worked as the Parliament of India, and existing Central Legislative Assembly and the Council of States were to be automatically dissolved. So now the Central Legislative Assembly, which was there according to the 1935 Act, that will be gone. Now Jinnah became the first Governor General of Pakistan. In India, requested Mountbatten to continue. Now the Plan Balkan. This is between March and May of 1947, before this Mountbatten plan has been finalized. There was a plan to transfer the power to separate provinces or to a confederation if formed before the transfer, with Punjab and Bengal given option to vote for partition of their provinces. The various units formed along with the princely states would have option of joining India, Pakistan or remaining separate. The plan was quickly abandoned after Nehru reacted violently to it. So in this, what is happening is that before Punjab and Bengal is being partitioned, this was an offer put by Mountbatten to Nehru. He said that we will transfer power to all the provinces and later Bengal and Punjab can decide. So basically in this, what is happening is everybody will be free. So then Nehru has reacted very violently to it, and he has basically protected the unity of country by doing so. Now problems of early withdrawal. So now because the date was shifted to 1 year before and it had to be done at breakneck speeds, The speed of events under Mountbatten caused anomalies in arranging the details of partition, and it failed to prevent the Punjab massacre. See, there were huge riots in Punjab when the partition took place. Okay, there was no transitional institutional structures with which the partition problem could be tackled. Mountbatten had hoped to be the common governor general, providing necessary link, but Jinnah said, "I will become." So there was a delay in announcing the Boundary Commission award. Now, integration of the states. There was a new upsurge in the state people movement because the people of the states were thinking that the this prince will become independent now and he will not let us live. So the Congress started supporting the Praja Mandal movement as well. So Nehru presided over the All India States People Conferences in Udaipur and Gwalior. He declared that the states refusing to join the Constituent Assembly will be treated as hostile. So hostile means at war with us. So he will attack those states now. In July, Vallabh Bhai Patel took the charge of the new states department, and the incorporation of states took place in two phases. By August, all the states had taken up, and so basically this is what we have studied in the polity as well. So basically Kashmir, except Kashmir, Hyderabad and Junagadh, all the states will come into India and they will be giving up their functions. That is actually only those functions are taken away from them, those are with the British government, the British Indian government. Now all of those functions will are directly transferred to the Indian government. Only this is what has happened. In the phase 2, they were given privy purse and made governors in free India. So this was how India was united. Now, was this inevitable? This is a potential mains question, and it may be asked in the mains, that was the partition inevitable? Why did the Congress accept partition? It was inevitable due to the long-term failure to draw Muslim masses into the national movement. The Congress had two tasks. That is, one, to structure the diverse classes, communities and groups into a nation, and securing the independence for this nation. So while Congress won us independence, but it failed to weld the nation, especially to integrate the Muslims into the nation. Only an immediate transfer of power could forestall the spread of direct action and communal violence. So basically this hatred, which was, now Jinnah was relentless. He said, "I want Pakistan at any cost." So there was no position to stop them. The Congress was not in a position. Now, the partition plan ruled out independence for the princely states, which could have been a greater danger to India. And acceptance of partition was only a final act of the process of step-by-step concessions to the League. Now, basically, when you started giving them so many concessions, initially in 1916 pact by recognizing separate electorates, then after that so many things happened. You have studied the whole movement. In Khilafat agitation, they were giving more and more things. And then during the Cripps mission, autonomy of Muslim provinces were accepted. So now during the Cripps mission, the Viceroy said that we will give the Muslim provinces autonomy, but Congress could have said that no, we will launch the agitation against that also. There was nothing on this ground set by the Congress. Now, Gandhi and Jinnah held talks. Gandhi accepted the right of self-determination. Now, if you have accepted that, then how can you stop them now? And in the cabinet mission plan, Congress conceded to the possibility of majority provinces setting up a separate constituent assembly. So basically, if you see here, that Congress is also not agitating when these things are being given to the Muslims. Now, official reference to Pakistan came in March 1947 when the CWC Congress Working Committee resolution stated that Punjab and Bengal will be partitioned if the country was divided. So basically they are not saying anything against it. So 3rd June plan, Congress accepted the partition. So now this is the last topic, that Gandhiji was helpless. Now, why did not Gandhiji say anything? He said that because there is a communalization of the people, there is no option but to accept partition, because people are wanting for it. Now, I cannot ask communal people to not be communal. So this is what the problem which Gandhiji faced. So with this we have attained independence, and the sad chapter of partition in the Indian subcontinent is also over. So if there are any doubts, and let me tell you very clearly that most of the questions coming into the paper will be from these sections which are now over. So now for you, Tanya and Shreya, both of you have submitted the paper. So now you must prepare for the next exam, which will be on modern India, and there will be one essay as well. After modern India, as soon as modern India finishes, I will be taking up social issue classes on social issues, and when social issues will be over, there will be a test on social issues and essay. After social issues, I will be taking up security, and when that will be over, there will be a test on security, social issues, modern India and polity. It will be a big test of all of these four topics. So the first three tests which you have all enrolled yourself for will be having an essay along with the subject which is going on. The fourth test will be a revision test, and security will also be there. Okay, so if there are any doubts, I have already taken the individual class with Tanya for the test discussion, and rest of you who are looking for it, you can message me, okay? But try and submit your paper on time. That also helps me save my time as well. Okay. So if there are any doubts or you wish to ask me anything, so thank you so much. I'll be ending the class now. After this, if you have any doubts, you can ask me on the Telegram group and join the channel. You can get the link to both of them in the description. Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you, Tanya. Thank you, Shreya.